Good morning. If you guys would like to stand with us and worship the Lord with us, it's a beautiful day. Let's praise God. In a minute.
She didn't talk long enough. Sorry.
Sorry.
Presence of my enemies, raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of a storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. I raise a hallelujah with everything inside of me. A hallelujah, I will watch the darkness flee. I raise a hallelujah in the middle of the mystery. I raise a hallelujah, fear you lost your hold on me.
About my weaknesses, so the power of Christ can work through me. 1 Corinthians 12:9.
Free. enduring friend. Your tender mercy like a river with no end. It overwhelms me, covers my sin. Each time I come into wonder once again, your grace still amazes me, your love is still a mystery. Each day I fall on my knees, amazes me. Your grace still amazes me. Oh, patient Savior, I fall on my knees, 'cause your grace still amazes me. Your grace still amazes. It's deeper, it's wider, it's stronger, it's higher, it's deeper, it's wider, it's stronger, it's higher than anything my eyes can see. Your grace still amazes me.
I've been set free, oh.
sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Whoa, I once was lost, but now I am found. Was blind, but now I see. Oh, I can see you now. I can see the love in your eyes, laying yourself down. Your treasure in jars of clay. So take this heart, Lord, I'll be your vessel, the world to see your life in me. Oh, amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saves.
Laying yourself down. God's grace. That's why we're here. It's how we're here. It's only by His grace that we are saved and able to then be called children of the Most High. I am so glad that you're here. Go ahead, have a seat. Let us worship in a new way. I guess first we should worship by just connecting. So as you grab your seats, would you either grab your phone or the connection card in the seat in front of you and just fill that out. Let us know that you're here worshiping with us. There's lots of ways. Like I said, you can fill out that connection card, put your name on there, put your address, put your phone number. And then if you don't want to do the actual physical connection card, then what you could do is actually pull out your phone and text CONNECT to 989-465-6431, and that way we will know who's here worshiping with us. And there's also an opportunity for you to share any praises that you might have, if you have a praise, because God is doing some amazing things because of His grace, doing some amazing things in our life, and we'd love to hear about those things so that we can rejoice with you. Or maybe you're feeling a little pressed down of sorts, you can let us know because maybe you have a prayer request. That's a great spot, because on that connection card, whether it's digital or the physical one, you can let us know and know with confidence that we'll lift you up several times throughout the week in prayer. It's one of our most favorite things to do. When you're done with that, also know, because of your faithfulness and God's generosity in us and through us, that we're able to do some other technology things. And one thing is, listen, during the week, if you have a prayer need whatsoever, you can text the word prayer, again, to the church number, 989-465-6431. You can text prayer to that number, and you'll get a little form, and then you can let us know what those prayer requests are. We stop. As soon as we see those things, we will stop and know that we will lift you up as soon as we receive that form. So just a couple things to maybe be able to help you out throughout the week. And then, again, because of your faithfulness, we're even able to do some upgrades. We're having some technology issues a little bit this morning, but it's really because we're learning some new things because of your faithfulness. We're able to upgrade in that because of your generous giving. We're going to give a little bit later on in service. And so that's kind of what's going on in the church right this second. But let's start with some prayer, should we? Let's bow our heads and let's go before a faithful God who extends His grace, who extended His grace through His Son, Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord God, we thank You. We thank You for today. We thank You for who You are. And God, we thank You for Your grace. God, we thank You that heaven does come to fight for us, that Your Son came down from on high to come and to dwell among us. God, how magnificent it is to know that the light of the world came to dwell among us, to live in a dark place, to illuminate it, to show us that there's something better and more for us. And that more is a Heavenly Father who loves us. If we just take the time to recognize it, that the more is a Savior who loved us so much that He went to a cross to die for us. God, we need to have that hope in our life each and every day. God, not just in the dark times, but in the great times where we can praise You all the more. But God, we also know that the times sometimes seem bleak for us because we sometimes allow ourselves to just get caught up in all the news. So Lord, would You grant us Your Spirit now, that You would allow the world to fade away, that You would allow the world in these moments to just pass along so that we can focus wholeheartedly on You. For God, we know that we are calling upon Your name to move when it comes to social injustice, when it comes to racism, when it comes to pandemics. God, we are asking for You to move in all those situations. But God, I am asking that You would grant Your Spirit fresh and new now in these moments, that the world would pass and that we would be fully focused on You and what Your word has to say to us then today. God, would You allow that? Would You allow Your Spirit to open our ears, our minds, our eyes, our hearts to receive whatever it is that You are saying to us this morning, to each person individually, so that we might be changed and transformed ever so much more into Your Son's likeness, into the likeness of Jesus Christ. so that you will be glorified, so that we will be changed and transformed on the inside and carry that then out into a world that so desperately needs you, that needs to know the love, the hope, the joy, and the grace that is our Savior, Jesus. It's in that name that we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. You know, these last several weeks, many of us have kind of started almost some new habits of sorts. I've heard of people picking up hobbies, and I've heard of people really focusing in on Scripture and just doing all sorts of different things. And I spent a lot of time these past lots of weeks in prayer and actually trying to get into God's Word a little bit more. See, there's a challenge that I have. I don't really like to read. And as a pastor, that's tough because you kind of have to read quite a bit. And see, I learned this about myself years back in even high school. I hated to read, and I knew that, but I didn't quite understand it fully. When I was working through the process to become ordained, part of the requirement, at least for this denomination, for this region, for this area, the leaders that I was submitting myself to, we had to take an assessment called the Grit Berkman Assessment. And in that assessment, it kind of begins to show you who you are, how God has kind of created you. And I learned a couple things about myself differently than what I already knew. I already knew that I loved outdoors. I love hunting, I love fishing, camping, hiking. I just love to be outside. I knew that, but I didn't know to what degree. I also knew that I hated to read. I always felt awkward. I felt slow. I stumble on my words. It takes me quite a while to read. In fact, just this week I was in a meeting, and there's kind of a two-page document, and the whole group was there reading this document together, and guess who was the last one to get it done? They all had to wait on me. It makes me feel awkward. But this assessment, this taught me something even more so, because it ranks a lot of different things in your life, and one of the things that it teaches you is that the certain things that rank pretty high, if you rank high enough, and there's like a number system in that, but it's trying to show you overall something. If you rank high enough, it is a necessity. Like, if you score to such and such a level, you have to have this, or basically you'll shrivel up and die. In other words, if you don't purposely insert this into your life, then you are going to be zapped of all energy and joy and just anything and everything that's good. And for me, that's outdoors. That's outdoors. But you know what I also learned in that? The reading is what zaps me. That is absolutely where I scored the lowest. And I scored so low that basically what they're saying is if you scored down to this level, you need to do anything and everything you can do to avoid it, because it zaps your energy where you have no joy, you just don't want to do anything. You could fall into depressions, really, of sorts. And I'm like, well, this is not going to work for me. I have to read. It's God's holy word. We don't live on bread alone, but every word that comes out of the mouth of God. And so I have to at least be able to read the Bible at a bare minimum. And I need to do that often. And yet it zaps me. And so during this time where we have had more time to ourselves, most of us, I spent a lot of time praying. I'm like, God, you know that I don't like to read. You know how it drains me. It zaps my energy. I was told I'm supposed to avoid it, and I can't. And you know what he said? Listen. I'm like, okay, I'm listening. He said, no. Listen. Like, I'm listening. What are you saying? He's like, no. Listen to my word. And so I have done something these past few weeks. In fact, it's been a little over a month. I have been supplementing my reading with listening to God's word. And I take my phone, and oftentimes, and I don't do this every morning, thank you for who sent at least someone sent one connection card in, but I open the Bible app. It's the one that I use, is YouVersion, doesn't matter, but I open that because in it, when I get to Scripture, Like, oh, there's one of the books I'm going to mention today, the book of Mark. It's one of the books that I've been spending some time listening to. But I hit the little button that allows me to listen to God's word. And so I read, but then I also listen. And so as I started this process, I really said, okay, God, where are you going to take me? Where in Scripture should I even start? And he's like, the beginning's good. Okay. I know those three words, in the beginning. Right? And so I clicked on Genesis chapter 1, and I hit play. And I listened. And I listened to several chapters. And the next day, I hit play again, starting in Genesis chapter 1. And I listened to several chapters again. And I have found myself spending more time listening to the same chapters over and over and absorbing it. And I said, okay, God, this is good. I think I'm really starting to catch the flow of this section of Genesis. Really, Genesis is kind of broke up into two sections. There's the first 11 chapters and then 12 and onward. And so I've listened to that first section quite a bit. And I said, is there something else you'd want me to listen to? He said, yes, the Gospels. And so I hit play on the Gospel of Mark. And I listened to the Gospel of Mark. And it's done something for me. God's word always does something for us. And I'm not even sure if it's something for me, in me. I don't even know exactly how to describe it. But there's one thing that has stood out listening to Genesis and listening to Mark. And it didn't take long in either of those books to stand out to me. And so if you brought your Bibles, would you turn with me to Genesis chapter 2? Because what stood out to me was one word. One word. It actually isn't written in Genesis chapter 2, starting in verse 2. It's not written there, but it's what it's talking about. Oops. If you brought your Bibles, I said chapter 2. If you didn't, you can grab the Bible in front of you, in the seat in front of you. Starting in verse 2. It's the seventh day of the creation. God has created so many things. In Genesis chapter 2, verse 2, it says, By the seventh day, God had done anything. By the seventh day, God had finished the work he had been doing. So on the seventh day, he rested from all his work. Then God blessed the seventh day and made it holy, because on it he rested from all the work of creating that he had done. There's one word that describes all that. Sabbath. A Sabbath rest. Now, turn with me over to Mark chapter 2. I found this so comical. You know, doesn't God sometimes do that? He just makes it funny to you. I believe it's page 814 for those who need to cheat like me. Page 814 in the Worship Center Bible. Verse 27. Chapter 2, verse 27. Then he said to them, the Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath. The Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. Those two verses, I can't escape them. I can't escape them probably because, honestly, during the last several months, I have been busier now than ever. I have had more conversations. I have been out running, doing more things, ministry-oriented, and doing a lot of ministry things is really good. It helps people. It helps them see their need for a Savior. It helps them in practical ways. It does all sorts of good stuff. And it also will wear a person out if they are not aware of Sabbath and what a Sabbath truly is. And I think that these verses and the time that I have spent with God praying and just meditating on that has taught me about four things about Sabbath. And I wanted to share them with you. I wanted to share them with you because I think that there's one question that has to be asked when it comes to Sabbath. And when sometimes we allow ourselves in our busyness, no matter whether it's good or bad, and especially even in the good, who are we then not to take a Sabbath rest? Who are we not to when the Lord God himself took a rest? On the seventh day, he rested. On the seventh day, he rested. He blessed the day because that was the day he took a rest from all the other work that he had been doing. Who then are we not to take a Sabbath day? Because a Sabbath day, when we really take a Sabbath, and it's not even necessarily a day, sometimes it's a season in our life where we just need a season of rest because we have been doing so much and we've consumed ourselves in so many ways with all the busyness of life that we need these Sabbaths. Because what does a Sabbath truly do? First, what I believe he has showed me is that a Sabbath helps us to focus on him. When we take a Sabbath rest, when we do this, whether it's for a day or whether it's for many days, for a short season in our life, it helps us to focus on him. When I take a Sabbath for a day, and sometimes, to be honest with you, I'll just be forthright. Sometimes I get half a day, maybe, because I've made myself so busy and I haven't held myself to the standard that he would hold me to. I fall short in that at times. And I lose focus on him and get caught up in just the busyness. And when I do, it's absolutely amazing because it helps me to focus on him by just being out in his creation. Again, I'm created as an outdoorsman. So when I get out, I see creation. And maybe that's not you. Maybe you're like, I don't like the outdoors. There are bugs out there. It is cold in the winter. There is this snow that I just do not enjoy. I'm not an outdoors person, so I can't connect in creation like you can. You're wrong. It doesn't even have to be outdoors. When you just begin to look at all creation and you begin to slow yourself down and you begin to see, hey, there's sun shining. And it's coming through my window if you're inside. It's coming through my window. Or if you're outside, you begin to see this big, giant ball of flame that hovers above our horizons and gives us beautiful colors. And it rises through the day and gives us light so that we can do work and heat to keep us warm. And you begin to look at the plants, whether they're in your house, whether they're outside of the house, and you begin to see these plants and fathom the life cycle that they go through. That they grow when there seems to be no life at all because it was fall time and they've lost their leaves. And it looks as if it's absolutely dead. And then this season goes by and without doing anything, green starts to pop back up from the ground. Because the warmth of the sun that was there warmed the dirt to allow the plant to come back to life. When you begin to fathom, then when you stand on the edge of a lake or on the edge of an ocean, and your toes are right there in that line where the ocean can only come so far, and you go, it's God that holds that ocean back. It's God that holds that lake back. It begins to help you to focus on him. But like I said, it's not just the creation in the sense of the plants and the sun and all that. Look at each other. Look yourself even in the mirror and begin to look even at the intricacy of an eyeball. Did you know that there are over 10 million colors supposedly that the eye can differentiate? Did you know that there's over 100 million different active cells in the eyeball? Or maybe you can fathom the heart. The heart. You ever think of the heart? The thing that actually keeps life going? The thing that the Lord God put there by design to keep you going, and without that heartbeat, you are no more. And animals, likewise, without a heartbeat, the animal's life does not go on. And that there are whales, the blue whale, a full-grown blue whale, his heart is about 400 pounds. Can you imagine that? 400 pounds. And yet, there's also an animal that's called, or it's actually a parasite, that is called a fairy fly. I'm sure the little girls love to hear that. But it's actually a parasite. And its full body, everything included, is 0.006 inches. And it has a heart as well. It has four chambers just like that of the whale. Can you imagine the size difference? And you begin to imagine how a creator could put something as big as 400 pounds in a big whale and as small as something that's so microscopic you'll never see it in life. That there's a shrew whose heart beats at 1,500 beats a minute. And there's marine life that can slow their heartbeat down for when they dive that will go down to 6 to 10 beats per minute. When you begin to fathom creation, it helps you to focus then on Him. And that really only comes when we take a Sabbath. When we stop all that busyness and we just kind of rest and look at the creation and begin to focus then on the Creator. And when we focus then on Him, we're really kind of starting to bless Him. You ever think of that? Think of it as an artist. Artists, or architects even, they love to watch people look at their work. You ever see people in an art gallery? And they put benches in front of these beautiful pictures or murals, and you sit and you just take it all in. Artists love that because they know that that person is slowing themselves down to say, what was the artist thinking? What is the artist trying to say about life, trying to say about the world, what kind of mood was that artist in? An architect, the same way. There's some basic architecture that's just, we need a structure that's practical. And then there's some real beautiful architecture. Those are some of the wonders of the world, really. And to sit and just take it in. You are blessing God when you just sit and take in His creation. And you begin to just sit there in the awe and the wonder of it. And it helps you to focus. But helping you to focus also then reminds us something. It reminds us of who He is. He is the Creator, the one who created all mankind, created this world actually for mankind. I want to go back just a couple verses from where we were in Genesis. I'm going to pick back up in Genesis 1, starting in verse 26. Then God said, "Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground." So God created mankind in His image. In the image of God, He created them. Male and female, He created them. God blessed them and said to them, "Be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground." Then God said, "I will give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth and every tree that has fruit with seed in it. They will be yours for food. And so all the beasts of the earth and all the birds in the sky and all the creatures that move along the ground, everything that has breath of life in it, I give every green plant for food." And it was so. God saw all that He had made, and it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were completed in all their vast array. By the seventh day, God had finished the work He had been doing. So on the seventh day, He rested from all His work. Then God blessed the seventh day and made it holy, because on it He rested from all the work of creating that He had done. You know what that tells me? Who He is a God of order. He had created for 6 days. He had put that sun there in place so that we would have a light. And that light then rotates, the earth rotates, but to us, it rotates around the earth. to us in our eyes. Because it hovers over the horizon and then disappears, then as a lesser light comes up, a lesser light that allows us to be able to close our eyes and rest and get some sleep. It's a God of order because that same light had to then be put into place to show that there was also a separation between dry ground and water. A place then for the plants that he put in place for us to be our food. That light had to be there to warm the ground so that the food that he was giving us could grow. There was an order to it, and our Creator loves to have everything in order. He's not a God of chaos, but one of great order. And we begin to be reminded that he is a God of order that had to do everything because we then, on the sixth day, mankind was created. We were created on that sixth day. There's an order to it because the creation was given to us and everything had to be in its place to prepare it for the pinnacle of all creation that is you and I, mankind, because that is what God wanted. He wanted to commune with mankind. He wanted to spend time with us. And what was the very first thing that man got to enjoy? The first full day, man got to enjoy rest. Did you ever think of that? The sixth day, he created man, and the first full day that man had in creation was rest. Some of you very, very much struggled a few months back when I said, what if we looked at Sunday as the first day of the week instead of the last day of the week? What if we looked at Sunday as the day that we get energized and we see the beauty and the awesomeness of God that carries us through the rest of the week instead of being beat down and then trying to refuel? What if that was the fuel that carried us through? What if God created that seventh day actually as our first day? It was. It was our first day. Our first full day was rest. Have you ever thought about life in itself? 9 months you rest in your mother's womb. You don't do work. God who knits you together, fearfully, wonderfully knits you together in your mother's womb is giving you rest to start life. It is his blessing then to us because he is a God who loves us. He is a God who thinks much of us. He is a God that wants everything in order for us because he wants only the best for us. And so Sabbath begins to help us to remember. It reminds us of who he is. But Sabbath also reminds us of something else. It reminds us of who we are. You ever think of that? Sabbath reminds us of who we are. We are his design. And it says that after mankind was created, God looked at all that he had made, and it was very good. In other words, the design was perfect. The design that was the light, the design that was separating water from dry ground, the design that was the plants, the design that was the animals, the design that was everything was good. He got to the pinnacle and said, it was very good. It all is now in order as it should be. You then, as mankind, you as one of God's created, that God knew before the beginning of all creation, you are very good. You are seen as perfect in his eyes. It's the choices that we make that is a challenge. But the work that he has done in you is very good because you were created in his image. You got to remember that when we take a Sabbath, it helps us because when we rest, it reminds us that he is God. It reminds us that he is God and he is pleased with the work that he has accomplished in us. The work that he has accomplished in us is good. It's very good, he says. So it begins to remind us who we are. One who is greatly loved. One that is cherished by a father. One who thought so much of us to give air into our lungs and bring us into this world at just the right time. Sabbath begins to remind us of who we are then in Him. A child of God. A child of God who pleases His Father just as we are, because His grace is sufficient. And as we begin to remember these things, as we begin to remind ourselves of who we are, who He is, Sabbath also refreshes us for our time of service. You ever think about that eighth day? The Bible talks about those 7 days that He created for 6 days. And even in His rest, think of this, even in His rest, He created. In His time of rest, He created this blessing that is Sabbath for us. He created something in His rest for you, because He also knew that there was work to be done. Because on that eighth day, what did God do? He started a plan. Because He knew the choices that mankind were going to make. I don't know when it is that Adam and Eve began to think different thoughts, began to go awry, to take that fruit, and sin entered the world. I don't know what day it was. But God knew what day it was going to happen. And so on the eighth day, He even began this work that was the plan of sending a Savior into the world, because He so loved us that He wanted us to have a way to spend eternity with Him. And so He started that plan, that work. And if you don't believe me, Jesus Christ Himself even says something. Let me find the verses. Christ is recorded in the book of John in 4 and chapter 4 and 6. He says, "I come to do the will of my Father, to do the will of Him who sent me, and to finish His work." So many times we think that His work was done on that sixth day, but it wasn't. His work began. He had to work a plan for our good. And that plan was Jesus Christ. And we then have work ourselves, which is why we need a Sabbath rest from time to time. We need it at least once a week, and sometimes even in seasons, because we have work to do, and our work is to be able to therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them all that I have commanded, not me, I as in Jesus, all that I have commanded. And I'm with you even to the very end of the age, He says. That's our work, whether we like it or not. That is the work that has been laid out at our feet. And a Sabbath rest begins to refresh us for those times of service. Those times of service that are each and every day, no matter where we are, whether we're at home on the phone with a friend, whether we're at a workplace, whether we are out at a store, whether we are just on the sidewalk, all those places that we come in contact with people, our work is to therefore go and make disciples. It doesn't mean that we have to browbeat them with the story, but it does mean that we have to be conscious of the work that we have, because we have a cure for cancer. You get it? Cancer's terrible, and it causes death. But guess what is worse? Sin. We have a cure that is Jesus Christ. And we have to share that, because that was His command. Those were the last words that He gave to us before He ascended to the right hand of the Father, to therefore go and make disciples. To tell them, you know what? There is rest, because this world, it wears on you. We make ourselves so busy, and even if we don't make ourselves busy, there's enough in this world that's going to wear you down, like you have worked like never before. But there is rest, and that rest is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is our Sabbath. If we understand that, if we take time to slow ourselves down and to see the Creator for who He is and the work that He did, which was to send His Son from on high down to here to die sinlessly for us, so that we might be able to be restored to a heavenly Father who wants to give us yet another Sabbath rest that is eternal life with Him. And that's the work that Jesus Christ came to do, the work that He referred to in the book of John. He finished that work on the cross. In fact, he said, "It is finished." And he gave up his spirit. It is finished. That's when the work was done. That's when his work was done. And yet he still works because the Bible says he never sleeps nor slumbers. He continues to work even then in us to prepare us for the work that we have to do, that is sharing the good news of the gospel. Those times of service that a Sabbath rest prepares us for. Who then are we not to take a Sabbath rest? When we were created in his image, he who took a rest on the seventh day. Who then are we? And so I am here before you to tell you that I am taking a Sabbath rest. Some of you have heard me talking about a trip that I'm going on. Some of you, maybe this is the first time, but Adrian and I are leaving to take a Sabbath rest. And we are leaving on Thursday, and we'll be gone for a couple weeks. Actually, it's just over 2 weeks, but it'll be 3 Sundays. So as I have prayed over what to do for services for you, I also remember that as I was preparing for ordination, what a blessing it was that I had pastors who believed in me, that gave me opportunity to come and to preach and to practice and to be able to give God's word. Even if I stumbled a little bit, they were there to support me. And so I feel, as I was blessed by pastors to do that, that I am doing that, and then in return to another ministerial student. He comes from Bay City Wesleyan Church. His name is Aaron Miller. Aaron will be here for the next 3 Sundays to share God's word. I have listened to Aaron share. Aaron is going to be a phenomenal preacher. He can tell stories. He just has that personality, and he can tell stories and give examples like never before. And so he needs a place to fine-tune that craft. He does pretty well already. I think he's going to be tremendous for you. And it's going to be tremendous for me, because I believe that this is something that is required of me. And you guys should be thankful that I recognize that, and that I've probably gone a little longer than I should have, because I need to be refreshed for service. Because as I've always said to you, we are in this together, and we need to lock arms and get to the work that he has laid out before us. But right now, I need some rest. So I'm asking for you to pray for me and pray for Adrian as we go on this Sabbath rest. And I'm asking that you pray for Aaron as he comes in. He has preached before. This is nothing new to him, but this is the first time he'll be preaching in a series. So pray for Aaron Miller as he comes in to share his word. He's going to be preaching on the Beatitudes. Maybe you can even go into Scripture and see Jesus' words and the Sermon on the Mount as it relates to the Beatitudes, to be prepared for that. But I will be taking a Sabbath rest, and I pray that I will come back greatly refreshed to do service then with you guys, because it is required of me by the Lord Almighty. I pray that you guys consider that as well, that if you feel wore down, that you feel like you need that rest, begin with each week taking 1 day of rest, 1 day of Sabbath. Begin to see who he is. Be reminded of who he is and who you are then in him, and see how refreshed you begin to feel. So I will be praying for you guys as well. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord God, I thank you. I thank you for your word. I thank you for what your word tells us, that you are a God of order, that you are not a God of chaos. And some of that order is giving us a time to sit back and to relax, to rest, to be ready for the work that you have laid out at our feet, to be able to be ready for the work that is sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. So God, as we go forth this week, would you help us to be ready? Would you help us today to get some rest, so that on Monday we can be ready with the good news of the gospel to be carried out into the world? God, I pray this in the holy name of of Jesus Christ. The worship team is back up here because we're going to continue to worship through song, but also through our giving. And so if you are being called, if you're being prompted in your heart to give, because we know that God is a generous giver, then please prepare that offering now. You can do so, whether it's through the envelopes that are in the seat in front of you, whether it's through text. You can even text to give. That you're going to text an amount, a number, and then text that to 84321. Or you can mail it in. You can mail it into the church, 110 West Webster Street, Coleman, Michigan. Whatever your choice is. But if God is calling you to give, then please do so and do it with a cheerful heart. Let us pray for the offering then. And what you can do is you can put that in the buckets on the way out. If you didn't do it electronically, you can put it in the buckets on the way out. But let us pray for that offering. Lord God, thank you. Thank you for your generosity. Thank you for giving us just all that we need. For Lord, you're the one who provides it. And God, you call us then to be stewards of it. And so Lord, these tithes and these offerings, would you multiply it? Would you use it in a tremendous way that we would be giving back to you a portion of what you first gave us so that others can come to know you as Lord and Savior? God, we pray this in the holy name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercies endure forever. I don't know how familiar you are with those verses or that verse. It stems from Psalm 107, verse 1. How many of you have prayed that for like a dinner prayer? I grew up praying that before, sometimes after dinner. And is anybody else in there too familiar with that? I don't know. It's more of a traditional thing. Anyways, how many times have I prayed that prayer and not really thought of the words that we're saying? I mean, a lot of times I have, but then I'm guilty of not really thinking about it and just going through the motions. Those verses, just say that again. Give thanks unto the Lord. He is good. And give thanks to the Lord because his mercies endure forever. His love endures forever. And we just, you know, there's just so much in there that, wow, that is so true. This last song that we're going to sing, and if you would stand and join us in singing this, sings about the goodness of God. So as you sing, as we sing, let's think about all the ways, or as many ways as you can. I know there's not a lot of time in the song to think of everything, but think of the ways God has been good to you. How God has been faithful to you. So, and give him thanks and praise him for that.
I love you, Lord. Your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. So good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. Darkest night, you are close like the water. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend. have lived in the goodness of God. Of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down and surrendered now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, surrendered now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Yes, I will sing of the goodness of God.
May the goodness of God make his face shine upon you. May he strengthen you. May he bless you. May he keep you. And would you then carry that goodness, that good news out into the world so that they too will know the love, the hope, the joy that is Jesus Christ. Have a great week in the Lord, and I look forward to coming back to worship with you again soon. God bless you.